We are tonight going to be looking at session 3, and we'll be actually in chapters 3 and 4 tonight. So we'll be doing 2 chapters. You ready for that? All right. So we're moving past the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw and was seeking interpretation of. We talked about those 4 kingdoms. We talked about the 5th kingdom, which is as a stone, like unto a mountain, not cut with hands. That is, it is divine. That stone would crush the feet of the 4th kingdom. We identified the 4th kingdom as actually a revived Roman Empire. So a Roman Empire that has tentacles going back in similarities to the original Roman Empire, one that will bear similarities and actually will rise during the time of the Great Tribulation and ultimately be crushed by Jesus Christ, who comes at the end of the tribulation. We would refer to that then as the second coming of Christ. And so we have some amazing prophecies that have already been uttered, and many of them have been fulfilled. Remember, when these prophecies are coming out, these are hundreds of years yet future. These are kingdoms not foreseen. And yet that's exactly what ends up happening. These kingdoms that are unforeseen fulfill the prophecy that God was giving to Nebuchadnezzar and was being interpreted there by Daniel and placed into the Holy Scriptures for us to study millennia later. So it's pretty exciting when you look at all of these things and how they've transpired, because as we come on through our study, we get towards the end of the book and there's much that is yet to occur. And if all those things in the past have occurred as they were prophesied, there's no reason for us and no reasonable person for any of us to doubt that the future prophecies are any less accurate. And so our faith grows even simply as looking at the scriptures and realizing what has already taken place and already been fulfilled. So tonight, we come to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3 and Daniel chapter 4, I believe they go together. I just really do. As you look at Daniel chapter 3, you see the unfolding of this image that is needing to be worshipped, according to Nebuchadnezzar. And we have Daniel's 3 friends, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, all going into this fiery furnace. And so it is pretty amazing how that aspect contributes to the overall prophetic nature of Daniel. So that's what I want you to see tonight as we go through this. When you studied this as a Sunday school class, maybe at some time in the past, they probably just took a snapshot of it and you learned the lesson. There's some great, valuable lessons to be learned in Daniel chapter 3. But when you fold it into the entire book of Daniel and you begin to apply it in light of all of these other teachings, you realize that this thing really has some significance. And there's some future prophecies that are yet to be fulfilled that are actually spoken to here in such a way with regard to this image that's going to be worshipped. And I'm going to talk a lot about that as we get going. So I'm ready to go. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll dive into it. Father, we thank you so very much for the blessings that you've bestowed on us. I'm amazed, Lord, at the prophecy that you gave Daniel. And in his day, he just interpreted it because it was a miracle that he was given that interpretation, that he'd be able to understand it. Father, I look at that and I recognize that Daniel probably didn't understand a lot of the things that he was saying. He certainly couldn't have foreseen certain kingdoms rising, and yet he gives forth faithfully what you've instructed him to do. And lo and behold, it all comes true. And so our faith is emboldened even tonight as we study the book of Daniel. Help us, Lord, tonight as we look through these passages that are before us to get a grasp of what you're trying to teach us. Help us, Father, to learn your word in such a way that it really impacts our personal workings in our lives, that, Lord, our faith might grow because of the time that we're spending in the word, and then, Lord, that would translate into a life that's being lived out of faith, a walk that is faith-oriented and not just by sight. So, Lord, we thank you for the advantages that you bring to us because we study the Word of God. So bless each one here tonight, I pray. May it be a sweet time in Jesus' name. Amen. A couple of things before we dive right in. There are a couple seats right here. There's two seats together. It's like trying to get seats at a sporting event like the day before, right? One here, one there. John?
Could you give like a two-minute brief of where we started? I brought my friend Jim with me and other people who maybe have just come.
Okay.
Give you just a brief two-minute overcast of what we've done.
How many are here for the first time tonight? Okay. And when you look through, hopefully, did everybody pick up one of the syllabuses, the booklets? So you all have those? Okay, that's one of the things that you want to make sure you pick up. I want to mention that if you want to backtrack, we have these going on to YouTube. Just look up Faith Community Church Gambrels. It will pop right up for you. We have the first session on there and any of the Sunday messages, too, going back a ways. And you can check all that out. Joe's loading those up, and so you can do that. Daniel begins, obviously, we did some history, and I can't go all the way back through the history, but there's a lot of history that's unfolding with regard to Babylon and the Babylonian Empire. And we're introduced to Nebuchadnezzar, who's the king of Babylon. He was a general, and he was very prominent in his military successes. And so when the king preceding him passed away, he was the next in line, and so he came in and he becomes his king. He's got a lot of talent. This guy's got a lot of ability. And when you look at Nebuchadnezzar's life, you realize that he has a lot of pride. He wants to be worshipped. And this is kind of where we're coming into this here tonight. Last week, I encourage you to get the video and you can go through and trace it through with your notes. Because we talked about the kingdoms. Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, and he couldn't interpret it, and all his magicians and all these wacko people couldn't figure it out. So Daniel comes along, and Daniel's able to do it because it was divinely given to him. He and his friends prayed. They asked the Lord for wisdom. God gives them wisdom, and he interprets it. And there's in this image, there's a gold head. That's actually Babylon. Then you've got silver across the chest and the arms, and that's Medo-Persia. And then you've got the bronze, and you've got from the knees down, you've got iron. But then you get to the toes, and it's iron and clay. And so it represents four different nations. So it's important to just keep that historical perspective. If you missed last week, we'll be getting to that again, because later on you have a similar vision and dream, and that gets interpreted as well along those same lines with some new information. So you're not too far behind if you're just coming tonight, all right? So follow with me here, if you would, Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3, we have the three friends of Daniel. I'm not sure at this point where Daniel is. It's very possible that he was out in the empire doing something, and it's possible he was sick. He's just not in the picture. However, safe to say that if he was there, he would have taken the same stand that these three men take. So let's pick this up. There's an occasion here for persecution that happens in chapter 3, verse 1, where Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold, the height of which was 60 cubits and its width 6 cubits. He set it up on a plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar the king sent word to assemble the satraps, prefects, governors, counselors, treasurers, the judges, the magistrates, and all the rulers of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. When you think of a dedication, what do you think of? So it's almost like when you dedicate something, it's somewhat solemn. We think of dedications. Sometimes they're political, but a lot of times they're religious. And I want you to think about this as a religious exercise. That's very important, because what's happening here is the unification of worship under the umbrella of this image who happens to represent Nebuchadnezzar himself. And so this is kind of Nebuchadnezzar's way of saying, I want you to worship me, without saying, please worship me. He's saying, worship this image. Does that make sense? So this is important to notice, because as you look at this image, what's happening here as they're going to dedicate this, these people have come together. It's probably, as your notes would say, approximately 10 years after they were exiled there. You'll notice that the head, the image was gold-plated all the way through. It's about 90 feet by 9 feet. If you don't know what a cubit is, most of us don't. 90 feet tall by 9 feet wide. Pretty amazing when you stop and you think about it. You realize Life magazine did an article about this, I don't know, 30 years ago. And they talked about all the gold that has been mined out of the world for 500 years previous to their article would be required to plate this statue. I mean, it was so immense. They estimated the dollar value, that is Life magazine, at $60 billion. Listen to that, $60 billion at $35 an ounce. So you can do the math. It's well over $2 trillion worth of gold at today's gold prices that went into this image. Are you impressed? I mean, I think we should be impressed. This is really something that is amazing. It's just really incredible. But notice on along the lines of that aspect of religion, notice what he says here. He's going to say that once they dedicate this image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up, it stood before the image, the herald loudly proclaimed, "To you the command is given, O peoples, nations, and men of every language." I want you to see that, because that's important. There are, at this point in time, in the kingdom of Babylon, several exiled people groups. There are many different languages that are there. Certainly we know the Jews are there. And these people are being brought together to worship singularly under this banner of this image. So it's very important that we take note of that. This is something that is much more than Nebuchadnezzar looking at it from the standpoint of saying, "Hey, I'm the emperor or the king, just please worship me." This is way deeper than that. And it projects towards the future in somewhat an alarming way. All right? So as you look at this desire to bring all of this religion together, he says, all of these different peoples, these different nations, men of every language, he says that at the moment you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, and he lists a whole bunch of instruments, and I like that, he says, and all kinds of music. Who knows what it was? You had the harp, the psaltery, the dulcimer. The dulcimer is actually the, if you took the Greek word translated, remember the Old Testament, at this point you're dealing with Aramaic, but it was all translated into Greek. You take the Greek word, it's the word we get symphony from. And it's the idea of all this wonderful music that was going to play. You're supposed to, when you hear that, fall down and worship this golden image that the king set up. And so this is mandated. This is something that has to happen. And you'll notice there in your notes, the desire of the king was most likely centered on unifying this kingdom that had a lot of diversity within it. By causing everyone to bow down to him, he was in essence creating a unified religion. Where have we heard that before? Where have we heard that before? This world that we live in is trekking forward, trying to create a unified religion. In fact, it's so significant when you come to the book of Revelation, you get into chapter 13, you see how significant the one world religion truly is. In fact, I'm not missing this as I'm looking at it. I'm realizing, wow, what Nebuchadnezzar is doing is pretty far ahead of his time. This is exactly what Satan has wanted to do all along. Satan wants to unify all of the world religions. Does anybody know why? Because he wants to be the one who is worshipped. Exactly. You go to a passage like Isaiah chapter 14, and you see just how deep the pride of Lucifer was that led to his revolting against the Holy One. And you see his desire for worship is insatiable. And so when he instructs, and I believe this is very satanic. He is moving in the life of Nebuchadnezzar. He moves in his heart to want to be worshipped. He's doing that because, in a way, first of all, you have this image, and I'm sure he was really handsome. Here we are back to this again, you say. You can't get rid of it, right? And if you were making an image, you'd make a smiley face, wouldn't you? I mean, seriously, put ears on it, and maybe a little hair, sideburns, pork chops, you know, all that. And, you know, I mean, it would just have to reflect you in some way. I'm going to put some teeth in there. Smile. I keep drawing the abominable snowman, sorry. Within this image that you have, the real desire is for Nebuchadnezzar to be worshipped. But that's really not the end of it. What's more important is that Satan desires to be worshipped. You see, if he can accomplish pulling this worship to himself and away from God, he is very, very content with that. And this is where our world today is morphing. We are morphing towards a global society. And the global society that we see developing right in front of our very eyes today includes worship. It includes religion. You have world religions that are coming together at very rapid paces. And on the outside, when you first look at it, you look at it and you say to yourself, wow, well, some of these religions are never going to get along with anybody else. You might think of Islam, for instance, and you think, well, the Muslims, they're just going to shoot the dissenters. But you'd be surprised at how much mingling is going on in the basic belief systems of these false religions, because at the heart of it all is this desire to bring everyone together and experience a type of utopia on this planet. And things that are bleeding through that we're seeing today are staggering. I mean, I am just kind of blown away by it. The person who told me to pick up this book, one or two, are you here tonight by any chance? All right. I had a gentleman walk up to me in church back when Dr. Burggraf was here. And he just handed me a 3x5 card, and he said, you need to read this book. And I went on Amazon, and I picked this book up. Well, this book, I don't know if I need to read it or not. This is one of the worst books I've ever, ever read. It is absolutely horrible because of not the way it's written, but because of the disheartening truths that are in it. It's a very, very sobering book. If you, I encourage you to read it. You ought to know what's going on in the world. I think sometimes Satan has us with our heads down so far because he's shooting at us all the time. We don't see the big picture, but it's called One or Two. One or Two by Peter Jones. Didn't Peter Jones sing? Is that Davy Jones. Peter Jones. Is he an actor?
No, that's Dean Jones.
Dean Jones. I don't know what Dean Jones is. Anyway, I remember Alias Smith and Jones, but I don't think that happened. Maybe you've heard of, for instance, and he goes on and he does this chapter, and he's quoting a lot of people that some of these people used to be known more as like your New Agers, but if you call somebody a New Ager today, or you reference crystals or chakra and that sort of thing, you're really out of date, because that's really not what is going on today at all. Things have taken on a much different aspect. But he goes on and he talks about, for instance, he says, in talking about integration spirituality, he says, integration spirituality merges with a popular movement of upbeat religious unity known as interfaith. All religions worshiping the same God. Study of the world's religions is fascinating, but sooner or later, Paul's analysis rings true. There are only two, and this is where the name of the book comes from, two basic systems. Either creation is divine and self-creating, or creation owes its existence to a divine creator. We would be twoists because we believe in a divine Creator and those of us who have been created. And we believe that those two stand apart. However, the notion that the oneness have is that within all of us, there is some aspect of divinity. In fact, there is a lot of books being written today that talk about life, and life itself is a God. And life is creating, it's self-creating, it's self-generating, and so forth. And it's pretty amazing how he pulls together, for instance, polytheism and animism, and the basic beliefs. And he even mentions that Albert Einstein placed his faith in this type of primary animating force. This bleeds through movies and books and all types of things in our society. But it's become more and more insidious as it has become more and more out in the open. I used to always wonder, you know, I've never been a big fan of global warming. You have to understand, in the 70s, I went to Bible college in Minnesota. It was 35 below zero, just straight up on the bank. I remember coming out in my car. I had one of those Camaros, you know, jacked up in the back because you had big tires and all that. So I went out there, and my air shocks had just settled right there on the springs. And I went down, bum, down there to the gas station, and I grabbed the air chuck, and I started to put air in my air shocks to get the thing back up so I could drive up to the Twin Cities. And when I got done putting the air in, I couldn't get my thumb off of the air chuck, and it froze it right there. It was 35 below zero. I mean, it was cold. And so if you ripped it off, you'd rip the skin off. But I didn't do that. I jumped inside and put it on my heater, and after a couple minutes, I was all set. Do you know, back in those days, they were all about global cooling, and it was about the world was going to freeze over. That's right. It was going to freeze over. And I'll tell you, it was so cold, you had us all convinced. Scientists had to be right. We could feel it for ourselves. And now we come along, and it's global warming, and there's a problem. What's amazing to me is that the issue really is not whether or not we're cooling or heating. The issue is this linkage that these people have in their teachings towards looking at the creation as divine. Remember, their oneness. And so if everything is in our world only pertaining to that which is one, and there's no creator, the creation itself becomes divine. And if the creation itself becomes divine, it is worth worshiping. You say, is that what this is all about? It really is. And you read, just get out there and read and pick this book up. I'll tell you, he's just got more stuff here that I can even go through. And I'd love to read more and more about it. But he talks about the worship of creation and how it comes in many forms. And he traces back the Eastern religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Taoism, and also the nature religions of ancient Greece and Rome. And he pulls it all together. And then he even looks at the emergent movement in our country. If you've ever heard of Brian McLaren, he's pushed this big time. And he would call himself an evangelical, which is what makes it so confusing. But he says that the missional goal of the church is not to make Christians out of Buddhists, but to make Buddhists followers of Jesus. And kind of a wow. But the interfaith religious expressions are scary because with regard to a Western atheism, it's really a form of creation worship, because it believes in the self-sustaining capacity of material reality and the power of the human mind. So much is being written. If you've ever looked up Sufism, for instance, you can check out Sufism and what that is, the pursuit of this truth. And all these different things are factoring into the main line. And your high-profile people, and this is what just really gives me the willies, is your high-profile people, people that you know, people that are running for office, okay, they have bought into this. And it is the philosophy of their life. And you sit there back, and as a Christian, and you sit there and go, what in the world? What is going on? Well, what's going on is this notion that you can teach this to many, many people, and it doesn't bleed through society. It's just not reality. It is reality, and it is coming through. And it's different. If you're older like me, it's different. We're looking at it and going, what? You know, this is kind of the wacky stuff. And we thought, oh, this doesn't make sense. But it's making sense to a lot of people today, and that's why it's an agenda that is being pushed forward. Ultimately, what it's boiled down to is creating a utopia, because within us is all of this good stuff. I mean, I look at the scriptures. The Bible talks about the earth. The earth, according to scripture, is winding down. They would say, absolutely not. You're absolutely wrong. This planet is just winding up. It's getting better and better all the time. But we understand that the scriptures teach that the Bible's very clear in saying that because the planet is under the curse of sin, it is actually, the scriptures say, groaning under the curse of sin. And we see its impact in the world in which we live. I'm not saying we shouldn't be good stewards of the things that God has given to us, that we shouldn't take care of our little spot. But the reality is, if you're holding on to this planet like it's your last hope, it is like going down with a sinking ship, because it is not. And the Bible is very, very clear to speak of us having a new heaven and a new earth that God is going to create. So we're living in a time where this is so important, because it plays into the future in amazing ways. Take your Bibles. Let's just go digging around here just a little bit. I don't think this is in your notes. This is all extra. This is free. Go back to the book of Revelation, would you? In Revelation chapter 13. In Revelation chapter 13, we have two, and depending on what version you have that you're reading from, in verse 1, the dragon stood on the sand of the seashore, and I saw a beast, or a lot of times that's translated creature. I saw a creature coming up out of the sea. That's a reference there to the one world leader, the Antichrist, whatever you want to call him. We're going to be studying that individual at length as we get into, for instance, chapter 8. So we're not all that far away from it here in our Daniel study. The beast from the earth, he says, then I saw another creature coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke as a dragon. He exercises all the authority of the previously mentioned creature in his presence. And he makes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first creature, though whose fatal wound was healed. He performs great signs, so that he even makes fire come down out of heaven to the earth in the presence of men. He deceives those who dwell on the earth because of the signs which it was given him to perform in the presence of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who had the wound of the sword and has come to life. It was given to him to give breath to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast would even speak and cause as many as do not worship the image of the beast to be killed. He causes all, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to be given a mark on their right hand or their forehead. We'll talk a little bit more about that as time goes on. This person we would identify as the false prophet. He's spoken of later on when the Antichrist and the false prophet in chapter 19 of Revelation are mentioned. The beast was seized, and with him the false prophet. And we know that this false prophet is the same person over in chapter 13, because it says he performed signs in his presence by which he deceived those who had received the mark and those who worshipped his image. These two are alive, thrown into the lake of fire, so you know where their end ends up being. Keeping that in mind here in Revelation chapter 13, where you have this false prophet, you have one who is unifying all world religions. So during the time of the day of the Lord, during that 7-year period of tribulation, there is without a doubt a world religion that is prominently on display, and the power behind it is individuals who are coming together thinking that they're worshiping the true God, when indeed they're not. And those signs that they see lead them to believe that this is indeed a true Messiah who they desire to follow.
This is after the Lord resurrects the saved.
This is after the resurrection that will take place at the beginning of that 7-year period of time, correct? So going back here to Daniel chapter 3, keeping in mind what we've just read in Revelation chapter 13, can you see the similarities? Well, you have this false prophet making this image, and that's exactly what he's desiring to do. He wants people to come and worship this image, again, throwing worship not only towards the image, but more significantly in Revelation 13. It's not Nebuchadnezzar, but it's the false prophet, ultimately the Antichrist, because the false prophet is deflecting that worship towards the Antichrist. The Antichrist gets worshipped, but who is ultimately being worshipped? Satan. And it's not until later on where we have this one, the Antichrist, actually taking the throne in the city of Jerusalem. And that's over there in 2 Thessalonians. Let me just read that again for you. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 mentions that. So 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 talks about this one who opposes. You'll see that down there in verse 3 if you're looking it up. He opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. Ultimately, that's where that leads. Revelation 13, that's where it leads. It leads to that midpoint where he, in this brand new temple that's been built for the Messiah, and he is in their mind the Messiah, but he's the Antichrist. He's a false Messiah. He comes in there and he receives the worship of men for a period of time. Let's go back to our notes. And in our notes, we see here that when this transpires, many, many people fell on their face and worshiped the golden image, verse 7, that Nebuchadnezzar, the king, had set up. For this reason, at that time, certain Chaldeans came forward and brought charges against the Jews. They responded and said, Nebuchadnezzar, live forever, etc. You've made a decree. They remind him of the decree that he's made. I'm sure he didn't really need that reminder. But he says, whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast in the midst of a furnace of blazing fire. There are, verse 12, certain Jews whom you've appointed over the administration of the province. You think there's a little envy here? Yeah, you appointed these guys. I mean, they got a higher rank than I do, but I'm ratting them out. I'm going to tell you, they're not bowing down. They're not bowing down. We got this image here. When the music plays, they keep standing. And it's a problem. And Nebuchadnezzar was filled, the Bible says, with rage and anger. He gave orders to have these men brought to him. What are their names? Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. And these men were brought before the king. And he asked them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you don't serve my gods or worship the golden image that I have set up? And you'd think, here it is, here about 10 years later, you'd think that he'd probably remember when they didn't eat his food, drink his drink, and they were in stronger condition. They bring an accusation against these fine men. And you can see that with regard to some of these people, they absolutely are anti-Semitic. They hate the Jews. Isn't it amazing how anti-Semitism just continues on? I mean, it continues on today. It is never going to go away. The world hates God's chosen people. That is something that is not natural. It is something I believe that Satan has in his heart because they are God's chosen people. He knows that there are promises yet to be fulfilled, and he wants to eradicate those people as best as he's able. But here's the thing. These three men refused to worship the image, verse 13 through 18. Nebuchadnezzar brings a test to them. He says, you fall down and worship or be cast into the fiery furnace. Nebuchadnezzar had issues. Can I just say that? He was always ready to rip somebody limb from limb. He likes to say that, right? I'll rip you limb from limb. You know, it's like, what? And now he's got this fiery furnace, and he figures, you know, everybody who will not bow down is going to get cast into that fiery furnace and will burn him right up. Well, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, in verse 16, after they get the spiel delivered to them, said, we do not need to give you an answer concerning this matter. In other words, we don't need any time to think about it. This is already a done deal. We know what our stand is. So the response here is that we don't have any defense whatsoever. They pled guilty. They absolutely pled guilty. Now, it's interesting, if you take your Bible and keep your little ribbony thing, here's my ribbony thing, I'll keep that here in Daniel so I can get back there fast. But in Romans chapter 13, there's a passage there that deals with human government. This is a well-known passage. If you've not seen it before, you might want to make some notations in your Bible. Romans chapter 13, verse 1 says, every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities. For there's no authority except from God, and those which exist are established by God. Therefore, whoever resists authority has opposed the ordinance of God, and they who have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. Good Christians tend to be good citizens. We believe Romans chapter 13. We look at government and we say, without human government, there would be chaos in the streets. And so we recognize the need for human government. We recognize the fact that God has ordained human government. And so our police and so forth, those who are over us, need to be prayed for and they need to be obeyed. Now, put yourself in the situation where these three young men find themselves. They're being called upon to bow down to a false god. In light of Romans chapter 13, you may look at that and say, well, they are bound to obey. But over in Acts chapter 5 and verse 29, a situation had developed, and you find some of the disciples brought to the council and the high priest questioning them, saying, we gave you strict orders not to continue teaching in this name, that's the name of Jesus, and yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. What's Peter's response and the apostles with him? Verse 29, they answered, we must obey God rather than men. So as I understand it, when we go out and try to practice good citizenship, our first desire is to submit to the authorities that God has placed over us. However, when there's a conflict, and we are called upon either to obey God or civil authorities, we have to make the priority to serve God. And that's where these young men find themselves. They don't want to just go about disobeying. I'm sure that they were wonderful citizens in Babylon. I'm sure that they were compliant with the rules. I'm sure they didn't jaywalk. I'm sure they, observed what they needed to. I'm sure they didn't swindle anybody. They paid their taxes on time. They were basically really, really good citizens. But you've asked them to do something now that's a sin against the holy God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me, God has said. And so for them to bow down would be to break a significant, and all the commandments are significant, of course, but this is a very significant commandment. And they couldn't do that. Just like Peter and the other apostles couldn't stop giving forth the gospel of Jesus Christ. I commend these three young men. I think they're wonderful examples to us. We live in a day where our faith may be called on the line the same way. We may be called into question as well. Will you obey us? And maybe we're saying the same thing. We pay our taxes on time. We do the things that we're supposed to do all the time. We try to be good citizens. We try to be supportive. We try to be kind. We try to be the right type of people. We aren't out there shoplifting and stealing and shooting and doing all those things to people that shouldn't be done. We're law-abiding people. But there may come a time when we find ourselves in direct contrast to the laws of God and be asked to do something that is wrong. And what will our response be? You see, that's the key. What is our response going to be? I want to remind you that these three young men knew what the penalty was before they said, we're not bound down. There's no litigation. There was no appeals. Can I get a lawyer? There was no lawyers. What you're going to get is you're going to get a fiery furnace, and you're going to get chucked in there. And that's exactly what Nebuchadnezzar does to them. And so the punishment is there in verses 19 through 23. As the Bible is going to say, during the night, let me go back here. Nebuchadnezzar was filled with wrath when they made the statement that they need to serve the one true God. And the Bible says his facial expression was altered He was ticked. He was so mad. The Bible says he gave orders to heat the fiery furnace up to 7 times more than normal. It was so hot that these men, when they were tied up and they had the opportunity to be cast into this fire, because the command was so urgent and the furnace had been made extremely hot, the flame of the fire slew the men who carried these three up there and put them in the fire. That's how hot it was. My friends, that's hot. That is hot. It was able to kill those people immediately. And yet, here are the three of them, and they walk right into this furnace. And so the victims here are not Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. It's the valiant warriors that have been spoken of earlier, and it's King Nebuchadnezzar himself, because now he really looks foolish and unwise. Notice here what happens in verse 24. Nebuchadnezzar the king was astounded. He stood up in haste and he said to his high officials, "Was it not 3 men we cast bound into the midst of the fire?" And they replied to the king, "Certainly, O king." He said, "Look, I see four men, and they're loose, and they're walking about in the midst of the fire without harm. And the appearance of the fourth is like a son of the gods." The identity of the fourth person here in verse 28, the question could be asked, is it an angel or is it the person of Jesus Christ? Just a reminder that all the Old Testament theophanies are really Christophanies, except for Daniel chapter 7, where we're introduced to the Ancient of Days. All of these are a reference here to Jesus Christ. Their supernatural deliverance here is due to the fact that Jesus Christ himself has come to deliver them. And you'll notice here the text is kind of interesting. They make the point of saying that there was absolutely no evidence that they'd been in a fire whatsoever. I can't light my gas grill without their evidence that I was out there on the deck. Okay. I mean, just the other day I lit it, and I had all the 4 burners going when I hit that thing, and I singed the hair. And you know what hair smelled like? I smelled it, and it was like, oh, man, that's terrible. These men have absolutely no markings on them. Even the smell of smoke is not in their clothing. It is a total miracle. And who is that fourth person? I mean, that must have unnerved Nebuchadnezzar. And so Nebuchadnezzar, he just can't even believe that this has happened. And he goes on and he begins to praise the God of Israel. He responds and he says in verse 28, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who put their trust in him, violating the king's command and yielded up their bodies so as not to serve or worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree," he's good at making decrees, "that any people, nation, or tongue that speaks anything offensive against the God of these three young men shall be torn limb from limb." There's the limb from limb again. "And their houses reduced to a rubbish heap." This guy is so loving and so kind. "Inasmuch as there's no other God who's able to deliver in this way." And the king caused Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to prosper in the province of Babylon. Now, the Son of God's impression on Nebuchadnezzar is obviously profound. However, I believe that his conversion here at this point is just a foxhole conversion. But how many have ever heard the term foxhole conversion? You're in a foxhole, the bombs are dropping around you. It's easy to say whatever needs to be said. "Lord, I'll do whatever you want me to do. Just get me out of this mess. I'm converting right now, God. Right now, I'm becoming a whatever." And people will do that. I think Nebuchadnezzar at this point is only an impressed polytheist with a slight confession. He knows he did wrong. He knows he came up against a force much greater than him. And it was sobering for a moment. But it doesn't last. So that's what brings us here then to chapter 4, where Nebuchadnezzar, the king, begins by praising God, praising the Most High. However, it is, without a doubt, hollow. It's a hollow proclamation. Because Nebuchadnezzar, in verse 4, is going to find himself here at this point in time to be at ease in his house, flourishing in his palace. And he saw a dream. The dream made him fearful. "These fantasies as I lay in my bed and the visions of my mind kept alarming me. So I gave orders to bring into my presence all the wise men of Babylon that they might make known to me the interpretation of the dream." So he brings those same people in that he brought in earlier in chapter 2. And they couldn't make the interpretation known. Finally, Daniel came, verse 8. He came in before me, whose name is Belshazzar, according to the name of my God, in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. And I related the dream to him. I said, "Oh, Belshazzar, chief of the magicians, since I know that a spirit of the holy gods is in you, and no mystery baffles you, tell me the visions of my dream, which I've seen, along with its interpretation." You may remember that Belshazzar is the Babylonian name that is given to Daniel. It might get confusing a little later on because we're going to be introduced to someone whose name is Belshazzar, okay? And he is Belteshazzar. So just, that confused me for the first 20 years of my Christianity. Verse 10, he says, "Now these were the visions in my mind as I lay on my bed." You'll see in your notes there, this is Nebuchadnezzar's declaration. It appears to be the last words that were recorded of Nebuchadnezzar. That is the words at the very end of chapter 4. Chapter 5, we're introduced to Belshazzar. So it's important to note that there's some comparisons here to Psalm 145 and some of his speech, where it talks about your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom and your dominion endures throughout all generations. Here's the dream. Vision seems to come, and it seems to come just before the invasion of Egypt in 569-568. And there is a one-year time period between this vision and when the vision comes to pass. Here's the vision. He says, "There was a tree in the midst of the earth, and its height was great. The tree grew large, became strong, height reached to the sky, visible to the end of the whole earth. Its foliage was beautiful, its fruit was abundant, and it was food for all. The beasts of the field found shade under it, the birds of the sky dwelt in its branches, all living creatures fed themselves from it. I was looking in the visions of my mind as I lay on my bed, and behold, an angelic watcher, a holy one, descended from heaven, and he shouted out and spoke as follows. Chop down the tree, cut off its branches, strip off its foliage, and scatter its fruit, lest the beasts flee from under it and the birds from its branches. Yet leave the stump with its roots in the ground, but with a band of iron and bronze around it, in the new grass of the field, and let him be drenched with the dew of heaven, and let him share with the beasts in the grass of the earth. Let his mind be changed from that of a man, and let a beast's mind be given to him. And let 7 periods of time pass over him. This sentence is by the decree of the angelic watchers, and the decision is a command of the holy ones, in order that the living may know that the Most High is ruler over the realm of mankind. He bestows it on whom he wishes and sets over it the lowliest of men." How amazing it is that we recognize that the Most High, capital M, capital H, speaking of God himself, he is ruler over the realm of mankind. Again, we're reminded of this. It seems to be a theme, doesn't it, in Daniel? God is in control. God is in control. He is the one who is setting up kings and setting them down. When Daniel heard this dream, the Bible says in verse 19, he was appalled. He's appalled. This is a tough thing. And he goes on and when the dream comes out, this great tree was symbolic of nations. Trees were actually prominent in Mideast dreams. There's a fallen tree, and yet the stump would remain. The tree here takes on a personality of a man. And number 3 there in your notes, the interpretation is, and Daniel is going to give it to him, and it was alarming to Daniel, and it will be alarming to Nebuchadnezzar, but this is what's going to happen. It means that evil is coming to Nebuchadnezzar. And this was something that really hits him hard. It really does. And when he tells him all of these things that are going to take place, the greatness, for instance, of Nebuchadnezzar, his greatness had grown. He was like this tree that's visible from all over the world. All over the world. And he is going to be struck down. Incidentally, after Nebuchadnezzar goes off of the scene, Babylon is never, ever the same. They're never the same. They go through some real turmoil as far as the leadership is concerned. The nation is no longer as prominent again. The punishment is amazing. When you look at verses, for instance, 23 on down through there, he says, "It's you, O king," verse 22. "You've become great and grown strong. Your majesty has become great and reached to the sky. Your dominion is to the end of the earth. and that the king saw an angelic watcher, a holy one, descending from heaven and saying, chop down the tree and destroy it, yet leave the stump with its roots in the ground, but with a band of iron and bronze around it, the new grass of the field, and let him be drenched with the dew of heaven. This is the interpretation. This is the decree of the Most High. You will be driven away from mankind, and your dwelling place will be with the beasts of the field, and you'll be given grass to eat like cattle, and be drenched with the dew of heaven. Wow. What in the world is going on here? For 7 years, you're going to have, according to this prophecy, the mind of an animal. Now, at this point in time, the issue was his pride. This was the problem. His pride was great, and God is going to take him down a peg. What a strange judgment that is coming onto this great king. And he says the purpose of these 7 years is that you will eventually recognize the Most High as ruler over the realm of mankind and bestows it on whomever he wishes. You see, up until this point in time, Nebuchadnezzar thought he was the great one. Nebuchadnezzar thought he was the king. He thought he was the greatest man on the earth. And God was going to show him differently. God was going to show him that this isn't about you as a human being. This is about me, and it's about my plans. Now, that's important to note, because as we go through and we get into some of these heavy prophetic parts in Daniel, we're going to notice that it is God who is in control of all of these things, and God has been orchestrating this all. And nothing's happened by chance. God has been in control. If God can prophesy that this is going to happen, that this nation's going to rise up, and this nation's going to rise up, I'm guessing he's in control. I'm just going to say he's in control. So here is this man who's this amazing person who has what some people think is clinical lycanthropy. You know the lichens? You ever watch those, like the zombies? What is it? Not the zombies. Werewolves. It's the vampires against the werewolves. I hate werewolves. I've always hated werewolves. I'm serious. I mean, I've never been around one, but they, as a kid, they always freaked me out. I would go and hide. I would look through keyholes. I remember there was a scary one of those like soap opera things back when I was a little kid, black and white, you know, and you had vampires and you had a guy who turned in on the full moon, you know, to a werewolf. That was pretty. That Dark Shadows. I wasn't gonna say it. Anybody want to hum Quentin's theme? Good. Interesting here, lycanthropy. They believe is a psychiatric syndrome. But in Nebuchadnezzar's case, he doesn't really have lycanthropy. He has boanthropy, because he's thinking he is a cow, some type of bull or something like that, because he's down there eating the grass. See, no self-respecting werewolf would eat grass. Just pointing that out, they eat like flesh. That's why we're afraid of them. I think Nebuchadnezzar is truly being judged in a divine way. God took away his mental senses. And for 7 years, he actually thought that he was a beast of the field. It wasn't that he had any notion that he was the king. He had no notion that he was even a human being. And so he was out there. And I'm sure the leaders were able to learn from Daniel that this was a temporary situation. It wasn't going to last forever. It was going to last 7 years. So they never brought another king in. They never brought another king in. Where's your king? Well, he's busy right now. I haven't seen him in years. Where is he? Where's he hanging out? Well, you know, yeah, he's really fond for the back 40, you know, and tends to hang out there a lot. Yeah. He's got these Holstein friends. Dew of the field, get on his back. That nobody really wanted to be around him to clip his fingernails, and so his nails grew, hair grew. I'm sure that he looked like he was some kind of werewolf out there with all the hair and the beard and, you know, the nails and all of that. But for 7 years, that's what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. I want you to see here that he had the chance to repent. He also had the chance to boast. And you'll notice here, Daniel gives a little bit of instruction. It is fine for Daniel to be able to give the interpretation to the most powerful man on the earth. But when Daniel starts to preach, Daniel's starting to get on thin ice. Because this king could have his life taken at any moment. But notice what Daniel says. He says, "Therefore, O king, may my advice be pleasing to you." And this is what he says. "Break away now from your sins by doing righteousness, and from your iniquities by showing mercy to the poor, in case there may be a prolonging of your prosperity." Wow, he called him out for his sin, didn't he? Called him out. Now, in no way is he saying that by helping the poor, you're going to be righteous. What he's saying is, if you break away for your sins and you're repentant, he doesn't use the R word there, but he's basically saying that when he says break away from your sins. And he says break away for your sins, and that true repentance is going to bear fruit. It's going to bear the fruit of righteousness, isn't it? When we're repentant, that is what develops in our life. We're going to show forth righteousness. And Daniel is saying, and it should be righteousness that is noticeable. And he is saying here that you might want to consider the poor. I mean, some of these people that you are oppressing. Just to give a point here, Daniel goes out on the limb and kind of preaches to him. Gives him a warning. He doesn't kill Daniel for that, but he doesn't heed it either. And his chance to boast appears here in verse 28. All this happens to Nebuchadnezzar, the king. So he has this vision. It gets interpreted. You know, he's sweating it out. But what happens when the judgment doesn't come immediately? We tend to forget, don't we? We tend to forget. Isn't it amazing that when the Holy Spirit convicts us, if we don't deal with it right away, what happens? Yeah, we forget it. We move on. And, if we don't act upon it right away, usually the change doesn't take place that God's trying to work in our lives. We tend to ignore it, we push it aside, and we follow after in another direction, and it gets misplaced. In the life of Nebuchadnezzar, a month went by, and, he's not eating grass yet, still eating filet mignon, and, he's enjoying his kingdom, and, it's all good, and it's pretty amazing, pretty wonderful. And the Bible says 12 months later, he was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon. He's walking on the roof. Up there on the roof, it was cooler. He could get away from the heat. He could also look out there and he could see all kinds of amazing things, all kinds of wonders that he has been instrumental in pulling together. And the king reflected and said, Is this not Babylon the Great, which I myself have built as a royal residence by the might of my power and for the glory of my majesty? I'd be hard on the guy if I wasn't as dumb as him sometimes. There are times when I tend to do the same thing. It's amazing. God gives us instruction. He gives us warning. And sometimes we just don't pay attention. Nebuchadnezzar is not paying attention to the dream that he had as it was interpreted for him. And he utters those words. This city was an amazing city. Babylon is one of the most amazing cities. And in fact, when Babylon falls, you could go to, for instance, Revelation 17, and you could look at that description of Babylon, that great city falling during the time of the tribulation as well. And that's pretty significant action. Babylon, as he looks out there, he's looking over an amazing accomplishment. He has been victorious over Egypt. He has been victorious over Tyre. We're talking 569, 568. He had those great victories. And he loved to build. In fact, this city was surrounded by a double wall, if you can imagine. And that double wall, outer wall, was 25 feet thick. You thought I was going to say high. 25 feet thick. And it was, that was the outer wall. And there were 40 feet in between that 25-foot thick wall and the next wall on the inside. Pretty impressive. The gates were elaborate, where they would come and go in the city. Ishtar was their prominent gate. It was 35 feet high. It was bluish and purple. Pretty amazing how they were able to do some of those things. He also built a 7-story ziggurat temple. The ziggurat temple required 60 million, you with me? 60 million kiln-fired bricks. And he inscribed his name in every single one. There was an archaeologist back, 1885 to 1920 he lived. He went in there and was excavating these areas. It was pretty astounding. He had discovered the Hanging Gardens. Let me just see if I can. The Hanging Gardens, they thought to themselves, these Hanging Gardens with these beautiful arches, couldn't possibly be the Hanging Garden because it was too far away from the river. And what they discovered, amazingly enough, was there was a use of a chain pump. He found a chain pump that was used to irrigate the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. Everything was thought of here, and it's pretty amazing. There was a triple shaft draw well. There's unique stone arches, lush gardens. All of this was done to honor Nebuchadnezzar's wife. The machinery designed to water the plants kept right on after Cyrus the Great would come in. It was pretty amazing. I mean, people didn't even want to destroy it. They were coming in there to destroy the city. And so when he is standing there, he is looking over some amazing things. Did he have a reason to be proud? Well, he was interested in more than being proud. It wasn't so much that he was just proud about what he had. You see, this is the same man that made this image. This is the same man who said, come worship me. Now, this is the same man who wanted to be worshipped, and it was satanic, the motivation behind that. And so here he is being judged by God for this pride that was in his life. And it's pretty amazing what happened. So while the word was in the king's mouth, verse 31, a voice came from heaven saying, King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it's declared, sovereignty has been removed from you. God is at work in the world today. And it is God who oversees all of the events that we see transpire. Now, all the world and the events we see transpiring are not good. But God works all things together for good. That is, the ultimate outcome will be good. And God will take these events that are meant for evil. Remember what Joseph said, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. These things were made for evil will be turned around and used as part of God's overall plan. That's pretty amazing. So we live in a time where we see things moving in a direction. And I'm really interested in this big vote tomorrow, right? There's a big vote tomorrow, Brexit. That's fascinating to me. Because if England votes to pull out of the European Union that they've been a part of for decades, it would be a huge, huge step backwards for those who are trying to produce this global utopia. It really will be. And so it's fascinating. But the national sovereignty of nations is not something that is looked well upon. We understand in July 4th, we're going to celebrate here, you know, the patriotic themes and so forth. But that's not something that's viewed in a positive way around this world. We're all supposed to be global. We're all supposed to be coming together. We're all supposed to be being enlightened so that we can bring about this utopia and cause this planet to really fulfill what it was designed by itself. It was self-designed. This is what it's supposed to do. And so we live in a time where it's fascinating to look at all these different things. So I look at the Brexit thing as is it God's way of saying, okay, not that fast, I'm going to slow you guys down a little bit? Or maybe it goes through. I'm okay with whatever. I'm just interested in seeing. I hope they pull out. I mean, that's my point. But, I like the idea of slowing it down. But it's all part of God's plan. And if it's not his plan to have that slow down, and God can take it at light speed if that's what's going on, then he'll use it for good. It'll all become part of the outcome that he's already laid out. So it's wonderful. We live in exciting times. Are you excited? Yeah. I mean, I think there's some amazing things happening. So here's what's happening here as we just conclude this. Immediately, the word concerning Nebuchadnezzar was fulfilled. He was driven away from mankind and began eating grass like cattle. Exactly what has been predicted takes place. And you see the judgment there, verses 31 through 33. The humility aspect kicks in verse 34. At the end of the seven-year period, just as had been predicted, Nebuchadnezzar raised his eyes toward heaven. His reason returned to me. All of a sudden, he got back his mind that had been gone for 7 years, and he blesses the Most High, praised him, and honored him who lives forever. He says his dominion is an everlasting dominion. His kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, but he does according to his will in the host of heaven. And among the inhabitants of the earth, no one can ward off his hand or say to him, what have you done? At that time, my reason returned to me. My majesty and splendor were restored to me for the glory of my kingdom, and my counselors and my nobles began seeking me out. So I was reestablished in my sovereignty, and surpassing greatness was added to me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise, exalt, and honor the King of heaven, for all his works are true, and his ways just, and he's able to humble those who walk in pride. Nebuchadnezzar is actually God's servant in a way. Looking back over here, in Jeremiah chapter 25. Jeremiah 25, let me just read that for you. 25 and verse 9. It says, behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, declares the Lord, and I will send to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, my servant, and will bring them against this land and against its inhabitants and against all those nations round about, and I will utterly destroy them and make them a horror and a hissing and an everlasting desolation. He was using Nebuchadnezzar as his servant. I don't know if that means that Nebuchadnezzar actually applied faith in God. I don't know that. You can debate that among yourselves. In fact, you can go home on your way home today and say, I think we'll see Nebuchadnezzar in heaven. Or, I don't think so. I don't have the answer for you. I know he was God's servant in the sense that God uses him as part of God's overall plan. But I'm not certain as to where his heart truly is. You read those verses, it seems like he's identifying God as true Jehovah, the Most High, and he says all the right things, but I just don't know. I just don't know. And you can read commentary after commentary, and some will say he was exercising faith in Jehovah when he woke up, and others saying he did not. So I have no idea. We'll find out. We'll find out. All right. You've been great. Next week, we'll do a little bit of review, and we'll talk a little bit about how these kings transfer on down from Nebuchadnezzar to Belshazzar, and we'll examine a little bit of the history, and then we'll get right into chapter 5. I was actually hoping to get into chapter 5 here tonight. I was fired up to get to chapter 5. It just isn't going to happen. Next week, we'll get into chapter 5. Here's a good thing. We're still on schedule, so we've done everything that we're supposed to do. So chapter 5 next week will be all set, all right? I can't wait to get to chapter 7 and chapter 8. And I can't wait to get to chapter 11 and chapter 12. And we're going to talk about all those prophetic aspects. But it's so important that we understand the base. And the base and the foundation is that God is in control. And he is working all these things according to his plan. Carries a heavier weight for us when we get into the, for instance, Daniel 70 weeks and that prophecy. So hopefully it'll be a blessing to you. Let's have a word of prayer, shall we? God, I thank you for each one who's here tonight and just our time together. Pray, Lord, that all of us would understand the significance of dealing with our pride and understanding, Lord, that there is only one God and it's not us. And understand, Father, that you are gracious, you are merciful. Notice, Lord, here the mercy that you showed through Daniel to King Nebuchadnezzar. while he didn't heed it, Father, I thank you that he said the right things at the end of his life. And Lord, in 562, when he died, I pray and hope that he is in your presence. Father, help us to understand the significance of Jesus Christ and what he has done on the cross for us, and that by virtue of our faith in him, Lord, we can have eternal life and have it in abundance. And we just thank you, Lord, for the promises that you've given us. Bless us as we go our separate ways here tonight. May you be glorified in all things, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.